For Westray Baptist Kirk. This is the third of our pre-recorded services, and although they've no been without their challenges either, we are getting there, hopefully. This is the day the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. There will be communion again near the end of the service. If you could have your elements ready, that would be good. Our songs today have been chosen by Stuart, Marion and family. Wednesday again is our prayer meeting day, with morning prayer time at 11 and evening prayer time at 7:30, both again on Zoom. If you have any items you need prayer for or people you feel need prayed for, please get in touch with Martin. Also, if you feel you have a prophetic word or a leading for God, please again get in touch with Martin. These are both parts of the ministry that we want to support. Next Sunday, we'll again have a pre-recorded service for you. And let's just open the service with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we just thank you again for your goodness to us. Thank you that we can communicate with our fellowship, with each other, through this technology that we have available to us. Help us to work on it, Lord, to make it as good as we can. And just guide us as we reach out to our folk. We just pray, Lord, that anybody that's struggling today for any reason will be open to come to you in prayer. We know that you there, Father God, are there for every one of us. Whatever our needs are, we can just call on you just to be guided, by supported, by led by you. And we just thank you again, Father God, for your goodness to us. And we just pray that you'll speak to us through this service. That you'll just guide our people, Lord, as we go forward in this time of uncertainty through this coronavirus. And we just pray, Lord, that as the lockdown eases, that we'll still be wise, we'll be sensible, and we'll be guided by you, Father God. And we just thank you afresh for this day. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Today's reading is through the Gospel of John, chapter 4, verse 23. Jesus said, "The time is coming, and has now come, when the true worshippers will worship the Father in the Spirit and in truth, for they are the kind of worshippers the Father seeks. God is Spirit, and his worshippers must worship in the Spirit and in truth." Amen.
Another way when the water with him will be through it all. So come with me in the space between all the things unseen.
Dear Father, we thank you for the symbolism in this picture, that as the sun rises, we have a new beginning, a new day to look forward to. And we thank you for new beginnings in our lives. We thank you for dying on the cross so that we can have a complete new beginning. And we thank you that you are quick to forgive us when we confess what we've done wrong, and that the Christian journey is a life full of new beginnings, thanks to your mercy and grace. We thank you for the airport and for the groundbreaking work done in the past to ensure that we have such a wonderful service. We pray for the pilots and the staff who work at all the airports within Orkney, who work hard to make sure that our communities are well provided for. And we pray too for our neighbours in Pabbie. We know how much during these times we miss being able to travel back and forth. They seem so close and yet so far away. So we pray for people that we know in Pabbie, in Sandy, in Stronsay, in North Ronaldsay, in Aidy, and all the other islands within Orkney. We thank you for the lights that show us the way so that we don't stumble around in darkness. We pause to think of those people who were our guiding lights in the past as we grew up, and we fondly remember them, those that guided us along the right path as we grew up, remembering parents and grandparents, remembering other family members no longer with us, remembering the founders of the Baptist Kirk, the Brethren, the New Kirk, and the Old Kirk, who have passed on the Christian torch to us. And we pray that you would strengthen us and keep our light always burning for you. We pray for our fishermen who come and go at all hours from the harbour. We pray that you will watch over them and keep them safe, and we thank you for them bringing us food. We pray too for all the workers at the salmon farms, again bringing food for Westray and for the United Kingdom and beyond, and we pray for their safety and we thank you for them. We pause to think of the big store which was built for the herring industry, but built too late as the herring industry boom was gone. And we think of how quickly things that seem so certain can vanish. And we pray for those throughout Orkney and the UK whose job situation currently is very uncertain. Please be close to them and bring them comfort in these difficult times. We think of gates and fences. We think of gates of opportunity and gates as a barrier. Which is it for you? Are you standing at a spiritual crossroad and wondering whether to move on to the next step? We pray for courage. Be bold. Don't hesitate. And we pray the words of the Serenity Prayer. Lord, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. We think of the barbed wire. Be careful that we don't put up barriers to prevent Jesus getting in, or to stop others from getting close to help us. We pause to think of our gateways of opportunity. What promised land does God want us to enter into, as a church or as an individual? And we pray that God will guide us and make it clear the gates we need to open and those we need to leave closed. On the screen in front of you, you should see a very well-known verse from Jeremiah 29, verse 11. Let's pray this together. For I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. They are plans for good and not disaster, to give you a future and a hope. We thank you, God, that in you we do have a future and a hope. And finally, I'd like to close with a prayer written by Val Kitchen from the St. Magnus Cathedral Guild, which Liz McVicar shared on the Church of Scotland Kirklink magazine this week, and it's called An Orkney Blessing. May the song of the birds fill your heart with joy, and the vigorous Orkney winds energise your soul. May all your days be filled with the vibrancy and colour of the wildflowers. May the outpourings of the Holy Spirit in your life be as boundless as the tumbling waves upon the shore. And may the glorious Orkney sunsets bring you deep peace, and the rainbow's promise strengthen your faith and hope in God, now and always. Amen.
Okay, well, thanks so much for having been with us so far this morning. I hope you've really enjoyed the service and it's been a blessing to you. We've come to the part in our time together where we're going to look at God's word together. And the passage that we're in is two passages actually today. We're in Matthew chapter 9 and two different places within that chapter. And so we'll start off at Matthew chapter 9 and in verse 35. So Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and healing every disease and sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field." And over into chapter 10, we'll just go to the first verse here. Jesus then called his 12 disciples to him and gave them authority to drive out impure spirits and to heal every disease and sickness. So that's our first passage this morning, but we're going to zoom straight to the second one, which comes before this. This is just further up the same chapter. This is one of the events and conversations that precedes this commission that he gives to his disciples. So this is Matthew chapter 9 and verse 14. Then John's disciples came and asked him, "How is it that we and the Pharisees fast often, but your disciples do not fast. Jesus answered, how can the guests of the bridegroom mourn while he is with them? The time will come when the bridegroom will be taken from them. Then they will fast. No one sews a patch of unshrunk cloth on an old garment, for the patch will pull away from the garment, making the tear worse. Neither do people pour new wine into old wineskins. If they do, the skins will burst, the wine will run out, and the wineskins will be ruined. No, they pour new wine into new wineskins, and both are preserved. Lord, would you bless your word to us and speak to us in deep and powerful ways that are specific to our situation and for those around us as well, God. Amen. So I think the first thing to notice when these two passages that we've looked at here, two distinct but related passages, is that Jesus' motivation is compassion. Jesus' motivation for his mission and for the building of his church, for the sending of his people, is always compassion. We see that within the first kind of micro passage that we read, down here in verse 36, Matthew 9 and 36. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Jesus sees the shepherdless people, and he knows that he has come to be their good shepherd. But he's got one eye on what he's just said in the conversation before. He's got one eye on the time where the bridegroom will be taken away from the church. That is to say, he will have ascended. Now we looked at the idea of ascension a few weeks ago. It was Ascension Thursday, and the Sunday either side of that, we spoke about what it meant for Jesus to have ascended and for us to be his body. While his physical body was taken up, we are now his body. And we looked at that quite extensively. And the week since then, we've had Pentecost, we've had Trinity Sunday, and we've considered quite deeply who God is and what that means for us. But something that we shouldn't lose in the midst of considering God and our standing with him as the church is that his motivation is always compassion. And we know from the Bible that that compassion doesn't end in our lives when we are saved. It isn't just that God goes, right, I've bagged another one, and then moves on. He extends his compassion into our lives and out from us into other people. And this is why he says that the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. And that it's important to ask the Lord of the harvest to send out workers into his harvest field, because people are shepherdless. People need the great shepherd. And those of us who are saved into relationship with Christ, we are Christ's body together. And so who is the shepherd now? We are called to be to shepherd people. That is, to meet the needs that they have en route to meeting their ultimate need, which is bringing them into relationship with Jesus. Of course, it's only the Holy Spirit that does that, but one of the ways that he works out that mission of saving people and reconciling things to himself is through us going and doing. And this is why he sends his people out. But I want to go back to that second passage, the earlier passage, Matthew 9, starting 14. That's really a passage about religious practice. This is a disciple of John that comes and speaks to Jesus here. This is someone with sincere question. This isn't one of the Pharisees or the Sadducees coming to trip Jesus up. This is one of John the Baptist, Jesus' own cousin. This is one of his disciples. And he's coming with a sincere question, and he says, how is it that we and the Pharisees fast often, but your disciples do not fast? See, he had his eye on the wrong ball. He was looking at religious practice. Jesus says, how can the guests of the bridegroom mourn while he is with them or fast? Other places say, how can the guests of the bridegroom fast? Because in the Jewish tradition, a wedding lasted 7 days. 7 days of a riotous celebration, and you would not fast in that context. And he says, the time will come when the bridegroom will be taken from them. Then they will fast. Most people agree that Jesus is referring in some way to his death, his resurrection, and probably as well his ascension. So when he is physically taken, then and only then will the disciples consider issues of their own practice? Because after all, there's no point in asking, how do I follow Jesus when Jesus is here with me? Like, that's a question you only have to ask when Jesus isn't there anymore. And so that's part of the point of this passage, is that Jesus is directing our gaze to the bigger picture. We want to ask, especially in the times of COVID-19, when will we get back to our building? What will the new normal look like in terms of church life? Jesus is directing us to the shepherdless sheep. The time will come when the bridegroom will be taken from them. Then they will fast. He doesn't say that in a throwaway way. Jesus is concerned about our religious practices. He's concerned about how we do church. It's just secondary, that's all. And for something to be secondary means there's something primary before it and beneath it, something basic. A secondary thing always comes out of a primary thing. So Jesus' concern here is actually a concern. He wants us to be concerned about religious practice, but he wants us to focus on him as bridegroom first. So for those of us who are saved and who are the church, for those of us in relationship with Jesus, then we are in this same this same kind of time slot as the disciples after the ascension. We no longer, in a sense, have the bridegroom with us, but in another sense, we do have him. And this is where this guy's question gets totally misses the point. You know, because we have to ask ourselves, is what we do as a church reflecting Jesus' heart for the lost sheep? This fellow's coming and asking, well, wait a minute, what about fasting? I mean, to see how ridiculous that is in the light of a world that is suffering, and a world that is dying of COVID and everything else, a world that is quite literally going to a lost eternity, a world that needs to know Jesus, a world that needs introduced to the bridegroom. So is what we do as a church reflecting Jesus' heart for the lost sheep, or is it really just like that first guy asking the question? Well, what about fasting? What about getting back into the building? What about anything else we'd like to bring? Because we're making the secondary thing the primary thing. We need to keep the main thing the main thing. Yeah, so as we look at that and we consider Jesus' response to that question, maybe we can reflect honestly on whether our faith lives actually mirror Jesus' concern or the concern of the man who wanted to know whether he was practicing properly. Jesus makes a link between our practices and his kingdom. And since the ascension, we are his body, like we've just said, we are his body, the church on earth. And so it does matter whether or not, metaphorically speaking, we fast. It does matter whether we might be back in our building or we might not. It matters, but it matters because there's a world out there that is quite literally going to hell. And this is Jesus' focus. He sees the sheep without a shepherd, and then he says, the fields are white unto harvest. He sees it white with fleece. The fields are white unto harvest with the fleece of lost sheep. And that's Jesus' controlling preoccupation. Why? Why is he so obsessed with people who don't want anything to do with him? Who don't really even know that they need him? Because his heart is for the lost. His motivation, like we considered, is always compassion. So that's a question for us. Is our motivation compassion? Or is our motivation the old wineskins? Are we trying to get back to the comfort blanket of religious practices that we were used to? The commentator, D.A. Carson, he says, the newness that Jesus brings cannot be reduced to or contained by traditions of religious practice. Just gotta read that again, because it's quite kind of wordy. The newness that Jesus brings cannot be reduced to or contained by traditions of religious practice. So that means a number of things for us. That means, first and foremost, that following Jesus means that sometimes we have to let go of the things that aren't working anymore. Sometimes we have to look at the new wine that we have for that day. His mercies are new every morning, right? And then the Lord's Prayer, what we're asked to, we're instructed to ask for our daily bread. So the flavour of God's grace sometimes changes, but often changes from season to season. And if we're using last season's wine skins, then this season's wine is going to burst the skins. And both those practices that we're trying to fit our faith into and our faith life itself will be spoiled for trying to put new wine into old wineskins. And so what we need to be asking ourselves is, first and foremost, do we see things like Jesus sees things? Is my concern for the lost? Is my concern for Jesus and his kingdom? So it's not wrong to ask, what about fasting? Metaphorically speaking, it's not wrong to ask, are we going to be back in our building? Are we going to have to use multiple services? What about live streaming? What about Zoom? What about these different things? These are not wrong concerns. Jesus is intimately concerned about our practice. That's why he ends this discourse, this part of the conversation, by sending his disciples out. Because he cares about what they do. And we can read it almost like a promise to this guy who had the wrong view of things. This guy was so preoccupied with fasting. He says, no, when the bridegroom goes, then they will fast. So Jesus has compassion on the lost, but he also has compassion on people who are lost in religion. Maybe that's us this morning. Maybe we're being so well fed upon the things of church that we've maybe lost sight of the non-churchly things of God. God has compassion for you this morning. In the midst of the disappointment of this season, of the confusion of this season. See, the questions about when will we get back into our building, impatient though they might be, slightly missing the point of the lost sheep though they might be, those are still questions God wants to attend to. God loves his church and he wants us to be able to practice, not in a way that's comfortable for us, but he wants us to be able to look at what we're doing and, yes, to reflect on it, but not get guilt-ridden. It's okay to be disappointed. It's okay to be upset that we don't have a meeting, actually, although having a meeting isn't the point of things. I think that's just what God would have us reflect on this morning. When we're asking our questions about how do we do church in this season, are we really asking how do we do a meeting in this season? Or how do we do mission in this season? Because one is the identity of church and the other isn't. So we need to ask ourselves this morning identity questions. Who am I before Christ? Am I saved? And if I'm saved, if I'm not, why not? If I'm in relationship with God, if I'm not in relationship with God, why not? And if I am, what does that mean? Does it mean that I just have these practices that I do? Or does it mean that I'm in a relationship with the eternal creator God? Or does it mean, thirdly, and I think this is what it means, is that we're in relationship with a creator God being freed up to do good works and to do practices that matter. And so I think we need to ask ourselves this morning, am I fed up on religion? Too well fed upon the expectations of a church meeting? Or am I fed up of religion? And I'm getting the mission part of it so right that I'm done with it. I'm finding COVID maybe a good thing. This is allowing me the freedom to press into different things. But what are we going to do when we all have to, both of those sides of the coin have to come back together after this pandemic? Are we going to get to that middle ground where we acknowledge that it's okay to be concerned with religious practice, but it needs to come out of who Christ is. And so this morning, I will just speak a blessing over you as you consider these things, as we have that heart check together. I just bless you in the name of Jesus to be concerned for the lost sheep, but to remember that the bridegroom, in a sense, is still with you. He's in you. We can draw upon him at any time. But if we've got a bit muddled up and our priorities are wrong, there's grace for us in that. And so, Lord, would you bless us this morning just to consider our outlook, consider whether we're concerned for church as kingdom or for church as a church. So God, would you, in the midst of this time of confusion and disappointment to us, this time of suffering, would you speak to us clearly and turn us back towards you? In Jesus' name, amen.
Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need you. Good morning, folks. Really good to be able to come together this morning to share in communion. And in the light of that, we'll just take a moment to give anybody the chance that needs it to go and collect some liquid and a bit of bread, and then we'll get right into the communion part.
So if we're all ready, we'll continue. I would just like to say that when we were invited to do this, after a sudden sense of panic, I think, my mind turned towards 1 Corinthians chapter 11, where we read the words, on the night that he was betrayed, Jesus. And then I stopped. On the night that he was betrayed. That night that was loaded with such a sense of foreboding, of sadness, sorrow and fear. That night at that very table, Judas was exposed as the betrayer. On that night, as Jesus sat around that table with his close friends, the disciples, on that night, the first communion service was held. How deep the Father's love for us. How vast beyond all measure. On that night, Jesus thought of his disciples. On that night that he was betrayed, Jesus thought of us. And on that night, he took bread and gave thanks as we do now.
Let's just give thanks for the bread and the wine. Heavenly Father, in the peace and the quiet of our own homes, it seems a bit different from the normal practice that we have to have in taking communion, but Father, we just thank you in this way we can come together. And I just want to come to give thanks for a body broken. And Father, that's why we take the bread this morning. And we break it. But also I want to give thanks for the fact that Jesus shed his blood on a cruel tree, all because of us, to give us the way back to you, our God, our Father. And so this morning as we share the bread and we take the wine, we come with heartfelt thanks for what has been done for us. And Father, just help us to truly give thanks, our worship, our praise and love towards you because of what has been done for us. And we give thanks for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Jesus, when he had given thanks, took bread and broke it, saying, "This is my body, which is for you. This do in remembrance of me," and let us eat together.
In the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." So let us drink together.
(Clears throat) Jesus said, "For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Let's just pray. Heavenly Father, we do come in total amazement sometimes that we realize just afresh what the cost of our salvation was. And so this morning we would just put ourselves again right in the middle of it all, knowing that we are so blessed, we are so favored, if we trust in that finished work. Our salvation has been bought with a price, a big price, something we never understand, but we are totally grateful for. So this morning, as we have done this instruction until he come, we just pray, Father, you might just watch over each one here this morning that is gathered with us. Bless them, I pray, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
The greatest day in history. Death has beaten, you have rescued me. Sing it out, Jesus is alive. Cross and empty grave, life eternal, you have won the day. Shout it out, Jesus is alive, he's alive. Oh, happy day, happy day, you wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day, I'll never be the same.
Service. Thanks so much for being with us. We trust that the Lord has blessed you, and we know that he'll continue in his presence with us over the next week. We're going to speak a blessing over each other called the grace. It'll appear on the screen in a couple of seconds, but before then, I just want to invite you. We are about to have a live Zoom call. It's just a virtual tea and coffee the Zoom meeting ID for that is 856-913-3780. That's 856-913-3780, and it's on Zoom. Please do feel free to join us for that. But for now, we'll part from each other with this brief blessing that's going to appear on the screen. Okay, so we'll read together. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and evermore. Amen.